Between the painless surgery, the revamped medical education, the highly urbanized setting of London, and the mentor, the stage was set for a revolution. Lister was a good student, don't get me wrong, but his grades weren't what made him important. What made him weird is what got him remembered. And I don't want to get all, this dude was the messiah of microbiology on you, but here's a quick bio. Lister was born in England to a super religious Quaker family, so one of his childhood hobbies was looking through microscopes and growing weird cheek beards. As a kid, he was super curious about anatomy and the natural world. He would dissect frogs, draw out muscles, and even prepared sheep skulls for display. It was clear from a young age, this kid was going to med school. And in 1844, he did exactly that. He showed up to University College London, where he got to room with another Quaker med student named Edward Palmer, an assistant to Robert Liston, who I mentioned earlier. Lister got to sit in on one of those first anesthetized surgeries, which was probably really inspiring and all, but it was his environment that raised him. Remember, super dense housing, overrun hospitals. These doctors could not escape infection, so they had to start tackling the problem with science. And there were two conflicting theories about infection at the time. The one that's closer to what we believe today was called the contagion theory. Disease was passed from host to host via chemicals or animalcules, a catch-all phrase for microorganisms. This worked for explaining visible diseases like smallpox, but not for diseases like cholera, which spreads through feces. On the other hand, the anti-contagion theory, or pathogenesis, said that disease came from filth and decay and spread through the air. That rancid smell throughout the hospital? That was the disease. The leader of University College Hospital at the time was an anti-contagionist. It would be a couple decades before we started proving that theory wrong, but in the meantime, patients kept showing up. So as a young med student, Lister was thrown in with the wolves. One night in 1851, Lister was alone working the late shift and a woman came to the hospital with a stab wound in her abdomen. Yeah, domestic abuse was like super common back then. She's got intestines hanging out, she's in bad shape. Now, many surgeons at the time would have just watched and waited. Maybe cauterize the wound at most. But Lister slices the abdomen open a little bit more, shoves her guts back inside, and sews her up. I repeat, he sutures up the stab wound. For the time, that was bonkers. Why was that so wild? Well, sutures were a really common site of infection. So doctors usually wouldn't suture up an abdominal wound because it was more likely to get infected. But Lister's impromptu experiment worked and the woman lived. Now that his career has taken off a little bit, the hospital boss, Erickson, starts taking him under his wing, which is great, but the hospital's still got problems. With such a small holding capacity compared to the population, they'd have to turn away people that they deemed incurable. Like, they had to turn down a man with tuberculosis and just, you know, sent this dude with an incredibly contagious disease back into one of the busiest cities in Europe. So what was Lister doing about it? Well, not surprisingly, his nerdy streak lasted well into adulthood, so he did what he did best. Looked at body parts under his microscope. A few months later, Lister had been put in charge of a patient who had developed gangrene, an infection that, believe me, if you've never seen it before and you're about to eat lunch, do not go Google it. Okay, you can go Google it, it's gross. He scraped some of the brown necrotic tissue off the top, then cleaned the wound with a very toxic, very caustic solution of mercury pernitrate before wrapping it up with bandages. Sure enough, the wound healed. From this case, Lister concluded that something in the wound itself, not the air, was responsible for infection. So like a good scientist, he took some of that gangrenous pus and threw it under a slide on the microscope and looked at the bacteria underneath. This is so gross, oh my god. All this very impressive work is while he's still technically a med student. So this all culminated with a job offer in 1853 up in Edinburgh with a surgeon named James Syme. And even though cities in Scotland weren't as packed as London, infection was still everywhere. This new environment, plus his mother's unfortunate passing due to a bacterial skin infection, led Lister to investigate what other scientists were doing to approach the infection problem. There were a couple scientists reporting similar theories, but none of them were really getting popular. They were all some variation on morbid substances being passed from person to person, and that's how infection spread. It started to sound closer to modern day germ theory, but not quite. So Lister started upping the cleanliness standard in his hospital, which basically meant sweeping the floors and washing off instruments with water. It was a good start, but not enough. Now, one scientist in a completely different field, in a completely different country, would prove to be the most impactful for Lister's research. In 1864, Everything changed when he heard of the work of France's Louis Pasteur. If you didn't pay attention in junior high science, Pasteur was like the founder of microbiology and, among other things, found that cells must come from other living cells. An infectious bacteria didn't just spontaneously generate out of a pile of poop, but instead had to come from a parent bacteria. Plus one for the contagion theorists and for Lister's microscope work. Since Lister couldn't always prevent exposure of a wound to germs, he focused on destroying existing germs before they multiplied too much and caused an infection. And he figured he could either do that with heat, filtration, or chemicals. Obviously, he couldn't boil the patient's injury, and the filtering technology didn't exist yet, so chemicals it was. And at the time, the chemicals that would have been used to kill these microorganisms, or antiseptics, were used once the sepsis had already set in, not as a method of prevention. One of his first proper experiments was on an 11-year-old boy presenting to the hospital with an open compound leg fracture. Lister saw his shot and decided to take it. Okay. The number one priority is making sure that this kid doesn't die. So he could have either amputated the boy's leg, which is heartbreaking, but it would have prevented infection. Or he could try to prevent infection with antiseptics and let the bones heal over time, which is what he chose. He tried a solution of carbolic acid and water first. There was some success at reducing pus, but there was still inflammation. Lister decides to mix carbolic acid and olive oil, and that worked. The boy made a full recovery, no amputation was needed, and Lister was finally onto something. It takes an overwhelming amount of evidence to start a revolution, and Lister was about to get it. That 11-year-old boy had an open fracture, a broken bone with an open wound, but Lister and other surgeons knew that infections usually didn't pop up in closed fractures. Okay, so maybe the key was in the wound. Lister recreated the carbolic acid method for abscesses, which basically become open wounds once all the pus is drained out, and once again, he had success in preventing infection. But an even bigger test came when his sister developed breast cancer and she asked him to perform her mastectomy, or breast removal. Obviously a big chance of infection with that surgery. Knowing full well that hospitals were still filthy, he covered his dining room in carbolic acid and performed her surgery at his house. She lived another 3 years before developing liver cancer, but she never got sepsis. And that's awesome, but the greater medical community still wasn't having it. They were having a hard time getting his methods to work on their home turf, even to the point of accusing Lister of fudging his numbers just for notoriety. Lister didn't care. He still had trust from his hospital staff and students, and importantly, the Queen. Queen Victoria developed an abscess in her armpit, and in 1871, asked Lister to do the surgery. Knowing how important this operation would be for his career and possibly life, he put a little bit of extra work into his prep. He went as far as developing a carbolic acid atomizer to disinfect the air in the room, which is funny because the pathogens in the air usually don't contribute that much to sepsis. But he gets an A for effort. Now, after surgery, the Queen started draining pus. Not a good sign. On the spot, Lister tweaked the new device and made it an impromptu suction machine. The Queen lived, and Lister gained a heck of an endorsement. After that surgery and a bit more time for the anti-contagionists to die off, Lister's antiseptic methods would become much more popular in the medical community. But not all at once. He still saw pushback from doctors in America, which is to be expected. Paradigm shifts take time. Germ theory still needed adopting, and word needed to spread out past Western Europe, but clearly, it did. Lister's story is cool because, of course, it's terrifying to think of a world where surgeons don't care about cleanliness. But I took away something else from this story. Lister would never have made the same breakthroughs if he gave up his childhood passion of looking through microscopes. His story is a cool science story, but it's also a lesson in staying true to yourself. If you're in the position of starting a new career, or if you're at a new school and you feel like there's something about it where you don't quite fit in, embrace it, enjoy it, and be a nerd about it. You might not revolutionize your industry, but you will absolutely bring a new perspective. And that might be just what your community needs. This video was adapted from The Butchering Art by Dr. Lindsay Fitz-Harris. There's a link down in the description to go buy the book. I super recommend it. Otherwise, go follow her on social media and support her work. She's really awesome. Have fun, be good, and I'll see you next time.